quite something. That's quite some audience. Hello to all of you who've come along to the Freemasons Hall. It's a very apt venue, a very historical and epic and fantastical venue, which I'm sure has seen many brotherhoods and oaths in its time. So it's lovely to be here. And also thanks to all of you who are tuning in tonight via the Blinkbox live stream. We've got questions from all over the world, and I've got quite a lot of questions of my own. And at the end of the evening, we'll take a few questions from the audience. First of all, a couple of two nice pieces of news for you. Some of you may know the first piece of news, which was that the Game of Thrones episode, The Reigns of Castamere, just won the Hugo Award for the best dramatic presentation short film. And the second bit of news, which I don't think anybody else knows at the moment, is that Fool's Assassin will go straight onto the bestseller list at number 4 this weekend. Well done. So, George, you're here without your trademark cap.
Yes.
What happened to it?
I sold it for $10,000. I've been with Prezio.com. I've been running a charity event for the last couple months for the Wild Spirit Wolf Sanctuary in Candy Kitchen, New Mexico, and the Food Depot in my hometown of Santa Fe, New Mexico. And we've had various. The big prize was a lottery to spend a day and a half with me. They would fly you in from anywhere in the world, and we'd have dinner together, and then take a helicopter ride down to the Wolf Sanctuary.
Wow.
Sorry, none of you won that, but we had many secondary prizes. So I put my hat up, and someone bought it for $10,000.
Wow.
So I have to send my hat off. I'll have to get another hat. Hopefully, one that no one will recognize me in.
Well, that was what was interesting, because Megan and I were at the convention at the weekend, and we saw you pass by us underneath, and nobody was bothering you. So I think we need to have a competition now to find you a variety of good hats, and you can go in disguise wherever you are.
I'm very afraid. Maybe one of the Pope. The Pope has a nice hat. That would be good.
It's not very anonymous, though, is it?
No, well, that's true.
We were also talking about author uniforms over the weekend. And I just wonder if you've now got your own style. You have your lovely waistcoat, and you usually have your cap. Do you find that it is a sort of author uniform?
It's surreal that you know that I've had got a uniform or something. I've never thought about that, but now I'm sold as a Halloween costume. I'm not even making that up. It's funny. Actually, last Halloween, you could buy all sorts of Game of Thrones costumes. You could come as Jon Snow or Daenerys or me, which was very odd. And when I go to conventions in the United States, there are always cosplayers about. You've seen there are some incredible cosplayers here. Have you guys been seeing them and enjoying them? Amazing, amazing stuff. And I love to see, you know, King Robert or Jon Snow or Daenerys or Sansa cosplayers going around. But I also run into me cosplayers, some of whom look more like me than I do, and that's kind of scary.
Megan, you are sometimes Megan Lindholm. Certainly when I first published you, I published you as Megan Lindholm. Every so often I come upon a manuscript which has got Maggie on the bottom, or indeed even Margaret, and I still don't really know what to call you, but then we know you now as Robin Hobb. So do you hide behind these different personas in the same way that George has his hat?
I think everybody has different facets of their personality that they turn out depending on where they are, whether you're somebody's mom or a sister or daughter or cousin, whether you're volunteering at a school or you're out being a writer for a weekend. So for me, here and now, I'm Robin.
Do you know authors who dress up differently to do author events, that they take on a persona out of their normal lives to present themselves differently?
I think most of the writers I know who have a set look or a style, they seem to live in it. Has anybody seen Neil Gaiman in anything but black?
It's true.
Robin and Megan are different though, aren't
yeah.
they?
Different voices for writing, different types of stories I would choose.
I remember I asked her for these anthologies I do with Gardner Dozois, Rogues and
Dangerous Women. Yeah.
Dangerous Women and so forth. I asked you for a Robin story for one, and you said, well, Robin has no ideas for this anthology, but Megan has an idea for this anthology. So we published a Megan story and not a Robin story.
It's a different tone for writing. It's a different voice. A little less sentimental, perhaps, a little bit more cynical. Whenever I get an idea for a story, I can always tell if I want to write it as Robin Hobb or if I want to write it as Megan Lindholm.
Mm-hmm. And can you remember the first story you ever wrote, George?
The first story I ever wrote?
Ever.
I never finished any of my early stories what I wrote as a kid. They were all beginnings.
That's not a good
sign. Endless number of beginnings.
Editors.
There were these spaceman toys, aliens, that were sold in five and dime shops in New Jersey when I was a kid. As an adult, I collect toys and figurines, and I've become somewhat knowledgeable about this. So I now know from the vantage point of a collector that these were aliens made by a company called Miller, and they're generally referred to as the Miller aliens. They were produced in the 1950s and sold through Kresge's and Woolworth's and similar stores in large bins for 15 cents each. They were made of extruded plastic, which was this kind of waxy, cheap plastic that like broke if you looked at it crooked and couldn't be glued back together to my great frustration. So they were very fragile things, but they were great aliens. They all had what planet they came from on the base, and they were weird looking. There was a snake guy, and there was a giant beetle guy who had like eight legs, and two of them had ray guns of different designs, and there was a two-headed robot, and there were all that. So I got the whole set. You know, and some of them were hard to get because the beetle guy and the snake guy were always breaking, and you'd go through the bins and, oh, all the beetle guys are broken again, but I finally got an intact beetle guy. And I made up stories about them. I decided, well, who are all these guys? It had what planet they came from, but they didn't have names, so I invented names for all of them. And I decided the Martian guy who was green, he had a big green head, he was holding a little rocket ship. He was the head, his name was Jarn, and he was they were space pirates, and he was the captain and the mastermind, because he had a big head, he must be smart. And, and I invented all sorts. There was one little guy from Orion, he was yellow, and he was holding this weird sort of weapon, the toy was. It looked like a drill. So I decided he was the torturer. So even as a little kid, I was thinking of torture and maiming and so forth. But they had all sorts of great adventures, Jarn and his space pirates, and those were the first stories I wrote.
Did you share them with anybody else?
No, they were just for me. Just for me. Printed out in my big chief tablets in my hand.
Aww. Mm-hmm. Megan, could you remember what you first wrote?
I can remember the first one I wrote. It was Halloween. I was sitting there in my witch's costume, and I wanted to write a story before I went trick-or-treating. I think I must have been possibly just past first grade or just at the beginning of the school year for second grade, or actually third grade. And George just referenced the Big Chief tablets, which were really coarse paper with the blue lines on them. Mm-hmm. And that was what I was writing on with one of those pencils they give you that were too big to grip properly. And I was writing a story about a black cat on Halloween. It was a very simple little story, and I remember giving it the simple kind of ending that you would find in a school book, where at the end, you know, everybody was sorry they had scared the cat and they were going to be nice to it. And I thought, that's not really satisfying. So I did not like my first story.
Did you revise it?
No, it went out, probably went out with the next day's trash. I do remember sitting down, and I even remember which book it was. Disney used to put out these little books that would accompany the various, like, Spin and Marty and things that they showed on the Wonderful World of Color and on television. It was this one about Andy Burnett and the Mountain Men, and I sat down with it and a piece of paper, and I copied out of that book onto a piece of paper to see what it felt like to write that many words in a row. And of course, I did not do the whole thing, but I quickly found out that your hand really starts aching. It's not not much fun.
I wanted to ask you, if you looked out of your bedroom window as a child, what did you see? And did it ever impinge on what you were writing?
My bedroom was in the basement. I saw the inside of the window well, and then because it was Fairbanks, Alaska, a lot of snow. So that was it.
So it was all going on in your head then?
Yes.
Well, for me, it would depend on what particular year we're talking about. From age one to age four, I lived in my great-grandmother's house, and my bedroom window looked out on the backyard. When we were 4 years old, we moved to low-income housing projects down on First Street in Bayonne. And we lived in apartment 114 initially, and then 2 years later, we moved to 116, bigger apartment with an extra bedroom. Both of my bedroom windows and those looked out on the courtyard of the projects where, you know, all the buildings had their backs. But there was, you know, there was a playground back there, and showers, and the women hung their clothing there. The living room window, however, was something else, because we were on First Street and Bayonne was a peninsula, so the living room windows looked out on the Kilvon Cull, the deep water channel that connected New York Bay and Newark Bay, and across the water was Staten Island. And where we never went actually anywhere, actually, because we had no money and we had no car. But I would look at those lights of Staten Island through the night, and they were incredibly romantic to me. They were like Shangri-La, or, you know, Middle Earth, or the land where you could never go, the magical lights of Staten Island. And big ships would pass on the way to Port Newark, you know, large freighters going up to Kilvon Cull and under the Bayonne Bridge. So I saw all the flags of the world, you know, the United Kingdom and the Scandinavian countries, China, Liberia, France, you know, you name it. I had a big encyclopedia with color supplements with all the flags of the world in the back. I'd always be excited when I saw a new flag. I'd try to look it up, what country it come from. Maybe that's where my interest in heraldry came from all those colors and patterns.
Fascinating. And the idea that there's a huge world out there, not just a little world, but a huge world that you're never going to see all of it, and
and
must come from so many different countries. And that's very interesting. I can definitely see where some echoes may have crept in.
Of course, the danger is that eventually you get to Staten Island and it's not all that thrilling.
I'm astonished at the level of detail you recall, that you can remember what house number you had at four. My nerd just kind of these...
Did you not remember?
No. I bet
you remember when you moved to Alaska, though.
When I moved to Alaska, I remember things, but like, if I had to summon up, because we started out in California, I remember we lived on Alston Way in Berkeley, but I can't summon up the house number or anything like that.
Well, how about when you moved to Alaska? That must have been a huge change.
In Alaska, we had, we didn't really have an address at first. We were on what was called a star route, where you just put out your mailbox and the mail carrier pretty much had to know what number you were on the star route. So.
And what did you see when you looked out from your home there?
Oh, that was the one with the basement window.
Oh, right.
I saw the inside of the window well.
When did you sell your first professional story? What was the first thing you sold?
For me, it was a story called The Hero, which I sold to Galaxy. I sold it in the summer of 1970, and it appeared in, I believe, the February 71 issue.
Wow.
Of Galaxy magazine. I had actually written it several years earlier. You know, when I was in college, I went to Northwestern University, just north of Chicago, and I was a journalism major, so I was writing a lot for journalism courses, but I wanted to write short stories and fiction. And I would take creative writing courses and write it for that, but I was also always looking for an opportunity to write short stories for other courses. I remember once I took a lot of history courses, and I would frequently ask my history professors if I could write a historical fiction for the, instead of a term paper. And some of them actually said yes. So it was actually a course in Scandinavian history that I was taking, and the professor said yes, and I wrote a story about the Russo-Finnish War of 1808, the surrender of the great fortress of Sveaborg, you know, a great mystery in Finnish history. And the professor liked it so well that not only did he give me an A, but he sent it off to a professional magazine. So that was where I got my first rejection slip. But it was a very nice rejection slip. It was, you know, it was... the editor said very nice things and said, well, we don't publish fiction, but if we did, we might like to use this story because it's good. So I said, hey, this sending out stories and getting rejection slips isn't as painful as I thought it would be, so I'll try it. And I took some of the stories that I had written for creative writing courses, some science fiction, some non, and started sending them out to magazines. And one of them was The Hero. And it got a number of rejection slips, but eventually it sold.
Do you remember how much you got paid for it?
$94.
There you go.
And what don't did laugh. $94 is a lot of money in those days, man.
It was
1970. Yeah. You could go to town for $94. It was. I had $94 in my bank account. I was pretty excited.
Did you go to town? What did you spend it on? What did you spend it on?
I don't remember offhand, but you know, beer probably figured into it somewhere.
Megan, can you remember what you first sold?
Oh, absolutely. I first started attempting to sell stories when I was 18. We had just moved to Kodiak Island, and I was living in a very tiny village there, and there wasn't a lot else to do. So I said, okay, I've always said I wanted to publish stories, so I will try. And I had a copy of Writer's Market and a portable electric typewriter and some paper. And I began attempting to write for children under the mistaken notion that writing for children was easier than writing for adults. Certainly the stories were shorter, but they were really not easier. And my first sale was, I think, to a Sunday school magazine. And it was just a very simple story about a teenager volunteering with children and getting frustrated and finding ways to go on with it. And I think I got $5 for it. It was not a lot. It was, well, it's a Sunday school magazine
but still
budget.
Special to see your name in print?
Realizing that I had figured out how it was done, because in all the creative writing courses I had ever taken, there had been a lot of talks about, you know, syntax and symbolism. But it was Writer's Market and reading magazines that I finally figured out it's black ink on white paper, make a copy, keep a copy, remember to include a SASE, which is a stamped self-addressed envelope, which either comes back with your story in it or sometimes with a check in it. And I had finally cracked the code of how you submitted a story to a magazine. So that was a pretty immense piece of knowledge I'd acquired.
George, you were saying earlier that a writer's career trajectory can be an odd one sometimes, and that it can take a long time to reach that one perfect shining moment that you seek for. What's the run-up to that like?
I think it's different for every writer. I mean, the one thing that's common for fiction writers, and I know in a crowd this size there are probably a good number of you who are aspiring writers or people who do write or think about writing someday. It's not a career for anyone who needs or values security. It's a career for gamblers because, you know, every time you write a book, you're throwing the dice again, and you don't know whether it's going to crash and burn or whether it's going to be a big success. Most books, of course, are somewhere in between. It's a career of ups and downs, and I've been very fortunate. I've experienced far more ups than I have downs, but I have had a few downs and, you know, dark times where I thought my career was over and I wasn't sure I was ever going to sell another book. What's important to me looking back on those is that even at the times where I was afraid I wasn't ever going to sell another book, I never doubted that I would write another book.
That's the key.
And that's the real thing that I think distinguishes a real writer from the false ones, that even if you can't sell the books, you're going to write them anyway because you got these stories inside you that you want to tell. You have these stories inside you that have got to get out and you got to get them down on paper. And, you know, hopefully you do. Hopefully you persist. But it's a tough gig.
It's a bumpy road.
I think the first clue is when you meet somebody who comes up to you at a signing or something and says, well, you know, this is what I want to do. And some people say, I want to be a writer. And some people say, I want to write. Mm-hmm. And I think that almost always the people who say, I want to write and I don't quite know how to get it going, those are the ones that, yes, because it's not about being a writer. Very little of it is about going out and signing an autograph or getting your cover art. What it's really about is alone in the office with a keyboard or a pen and a pencil, pencil and paper somewhere, and actually just doing the writing because you want to write.
And wrestling with it, and the obstinacy that writers must have. Do you think writers have to be a certain sort of character? You have to be quite obdurate and quite bloody-minded, I think, in your own skin. You have to be quite determined to just keep doing it.
Yes, and you know, you have to be ready to take a certain amount of criticism and rejection. You are going to get the rejection slips. You're going to work for projects that you love, and people aren't going to understand what you're doing, and you know, and boy, for most writers, you can work for a year or 2 years on a book, and even if you sell it and get it published, then it's like you threw it down a well. You know, you scan, oh, here's one review in a newspaper from Des Moines, Iowa, and that's the only notice that you get for that. If you're lucky enough to be sent out for your publisher on book tours, you find yourself sitting in a mall for 3 or 4 hours and no one is coming, and then suddenly someone, you got a big stack of books in front of you, and and you see someone coming up to you. Oh, finally, I have a customer. Yes, hi. And she says, where are the cookbooks? That's the kind of experience you have.
Exactly.
So it's not all, you know, book launches with champagne and interviews by the New York Times or the London Times, as the case may be. But it is a casino, and sometimes someone like me gets lucky, and you do get the end of it, which has its own challenges, but its own rewards as too. The main thing is the stories, though. It's exactly as Robin said. All of the other stuff is fun, or not fun, as the case may be. But ultimately, you want to get back to that room, and you want to get back to your people, to Fitz and the Fool in your case, or to, in my case, to Tyrion and Arya and Jon Snow and so forth and so on.
Absolutely, the best feeling is the feeling that you get when you're really reading a really cool book and you have to put it down because it's time to do something else, cook dinner or do homework or whatever, and that feeling of I'm going to go back to that and I'm going to jump back into that story. Mm-hmm. And when that happens and you realize that's the story I was writing, that is that moment in when it shifts gears and you say, I hope somebody else is going to feel about this like I am, because I can't wait to get back and finish what's going to happen. That was a watershed moment for
me
when that
happened.
That's
a special moment.
Oh, yes.
It's a curious thing, this. I know exactly what you're feeling, and there are mm-hmm. there are books. I love it when I find a book like that. The book that, at the end of the day, I can't wait to mm-hmm. read a few more chapters before I go to sleep. And sometimes it grabs me, and then I don't go to sleep. I stay up all night reading it. Yeah. That's great, but... Sometimes I wonder what the quality is. What is that readability? I suppose it's the job of editors like Jane to find that, because sometimes I find myself reading a book critically and saying, this isn't right. No, I could do better than this. This is, I'm not convinced by this, but I'm still reading the chapters because mm-hmm. the book has me hooked, even though I'm criticizing it in my brain.
Really?
And just the reverse, other books I read, sometimes very highly praised books. Oh, this is beautiful prose. Oh, this is he's really got a gift here. This is terrific. And I put it down and I never pick it up again.
Right.
Even though I have this great intellectual admiration, somehow mm-hmm. the hook's not being set. And I don't know quite what the distinction is. I don't know if anybody knows. If we knew, we would all be doing it with every book, right? Yeah. We would bottle it and sell it, but it's that's why it's an art and not a
it's
hard
a hunch.
Science.
Every book, when you're reading manuscripts, it's a hunch. And you know, and even those don't always work. Even if you like it, not everybody else is going to like it. So mm-hmm. it's very intangible. I don't know what it is, but I know exactly what you mean about a very highly praised book, and you can really think it's remarkably well written, but it just hasn't got you. And I now put those away. I haven't got time mm-hmm. to waste on things that I'm not going to enjoy. It's a very magical process, reading. I think it's the most personal thing you can ever do, because it's just you and that story, and nobody else can interfere with it while you're sharing that book. And that's an amazing thing. But also, writing is a very magical process as well, and that's also an intangible, extraordinary process. And remember, over the weekend, you described it so beautifully, Megan. You said it was like chasing butterflies and trying not to crush them. It's somehow trying to capture that moment of inspiration and get it down on paper. Can you talk a bit more about that?
Well, there was a lovely book out, and I think I'm going to mess up the title, but it was a fairy book, and it was about this lovely Victorian lady that was catching fairies in the book. Was it the Crushed Fairy book? It had a title similar to that. And really, for me, writing is like that. I get an idea, I think, I can see it, it's absolutely beautiful, and I start writing it, and I get it trapped on the page, and it looks like it's not what I thought I was going to write. And then the rewrite is it's rearranging the little body to make it look nice. But it's taking off the paragraphs that didn't work and coming back to it and saying, I didn't describe anything. I just said they walked into the room I'm not in the room with them because I haven't bothered to slow down and describe it. So for me, it's I enjoy rewriting much more than I do doing first drafts. Doing first drafts, it's really hard. And then rewriting, you've at least got something to work with, and you can always make it better. But the initial writing,
you can make it worse too.
We hope not. But first drafts are very hard for me.
George, how are you?
I agree with what everything Robin said about how hard it is. You know, one of the key bits of writing advice that I got from a book was when I was quite young, before I'd made any sales, when I was writing for fanzines and all that, was Robert A. Heinlein's Four Rules of Writing, which was, you must write was number one, because a lot of people talk, I'm going to write someday, but they never actually get around to writing anything. So that one, I was already writing, so that one didn't make much sense to me, although I could see the sense of it. But the second one, you must finish what you write. That was very important to me at an early age, because I was constantly not finishing what I liked. I was buried in fragments for precisely the reasons that Robin talked about. I would have this story idea, and it would exist in my head in this platonic perfection. Yeah. And I would sit down to try to capture it, and I'd be writing on it and wrestling it and writing with these words, and then I would look at it, and it was not the beautiful dream city that I had imagined. It was this kind of slum of words, and no, I didn't get it right. It was horrible. And I'd get like halfway through it, and then I'd have another idea, and that would exist in platonic perfection and would seem so much more attractive than this mess that I had half written on paper. So I'd put the mess aside, and I'd start a new story, and exactly the same thing that would happen. And so it was really the Heinlein thing that said, you must finish what you write. And I made myself start actually finishing these stories, no matter how much I hated, loathed, and despised them. Wow. And, you know, by the end, I usually liked them a little better, and they still weren't the incredible stories that I saw in my head. But, you know, they were good enough that, at least for fanzines, and fans seemed to like them, and that encouraged me, and I did more. And, you know, then after the Scandinavian story got rejected, I said, well, maybe I'll send some out, and one thing led to another. But it's hard. It's still hard. I mean, if there was just telepathy, mm-hmm. you know, there's part of me that loves words. I mean, I feel great pleasure when I come up with a great line of dialogue, or even a way of describing a sunset or a castle, a metaphor, something that where the words ring, where the words have some poetry to them. That's terrific. But sometimes it seems like the words are, you know, you're trying to drive a nail with your shoe, and it's boy, you wish you had a hammer, and the hammer is a word that you don't have, or some way to make the reader see this the way you see it, and it can be very very frustrating.
Thomas Mann said that a writer is someone for whom writing is more difficult than it is for other people. Absolutely spot on. It really exactly. is. Do you ever have doubts when you look at an empty screen or page?
Of course, but for me the worst doubts come in the 5 minutes after I've hit send. I think I've written this beautiful story. I've written it. I've rewritten it. I'm so sure it's finished and ready, and I hit send, and longer than 5 minutes, I'm walking around the house chortling to myself, "That's done. I should make a sandwich. I should go for a walk. Oh, wait a minute. There was that piece in that one chapter where I was going to go back and fix that. Did I fix that? No, I didn't. And then there's, you know, I really should have inserted one more scene because it would make this action so much clearer if I did it. So, you know, by the time the evening's through, I am convinced I have written the stupidest and most horrible book in the universe, and that Jane is going to not even bother to send it back to me. That's the toughest day is that immediately after the book is finished the first time. That's before we do the editing. Because there's such a process. It's not I write the book and I send it to you and you say, oh, I like this, and you publish it. Getting it off the word processor and sending it out is the beginning of a different kind of work for about a year.
And how do you cope with editing? Because I know some of the writers that I critique and I send an editorial letter back, I have heard from some of them that they go and lock themselves in the bathroom and scream for 10 minutes when they get this back. And then some of them don't speak to me for quite some time. But you're always very polite to me, and I just wonder, but there's always a gap when I haven't heard from you. So I always suspect that you are going somewhere and screaming.
One thing that I have worked with you for 27 years, and that is nothing short of miraculous in today's market and today how editors move around and publishing mm-hmm. houses spring up and are eaten by other publishing houses, and people are made redundant. And so I've worked with you for 27 years.
I have been eaten several times during that course of that, and spat back up again.
So usually I get editorial notes from you, and I get editorial notes from Anne, and if I'm lucky, they come in at about the same time. And then it's sitting down with your ideas and Anne's idea and my book on the screen, and trying to make it something that works for me, but incorporates what you've seen wrong and what Anne has seen wrong. And when both my editors say to me, "This is really bad, you need to change this," I ignore that at my peril. There was one time when I said, "No, that doesn't slow the action down. That's fine. That scene is good. I need them to stop and talk about things and think about things." And both Anne and Jane said, "Well, it's your book. We'll leave it like that." And about 6 months later, I was writing, I think it was the third book in the trilogy, and I had to go back and reference something. So I was leafing through, and I started reading the book, and I hit that scene and went, "Oh, I should have listened to them." No, I don't go in the bathroom and scream, but there usually is that comparison process of notes.
When I bought both, well, when I didn't buy George's work initially, but I was part of the editorial team who was pushing to buy A Song of Ice and Fire when it first came in as a trilogy. And we were actually at it was our fiction department Christmas lunch, in fact, when the agent sent it through to us. Much wine was taken. And we were all going, no, we have to have this book, just offer more. We don't care, however much it takes, just buy it. Very sneaky though, because the chunk that we got ended with Bran falling off the tower. How could we not want to read on after that? But originally, that was conceived of as a trilogy. That was how we saw it. So, did you have any concept of just how vast the story arc was going to be when you set out, like Magellan going round the world?
I didn't. No, I thought it could be a trilogy. It was initially proposed to be a Game of Thrones, a Dance with Dragons, and Winds of Winter with three initial titles. There was a period there where I thought I'd never get to a Dance with Dragons because the second book became the third book, and then it became the fourth book, and then it became the fifth book. But I finally did get it out as the fifth book. And even then, I didn't get everything into it that I had originally thought when it was going to be a trilogy. The tale grew in the telling. Fortunately, I had Tolkien to come up with that wonderful phrase. It's all very well to discuss some of these things in outline, but then when you actually sit down and write them, other thoughts occur to you, secondary characters come in, you think of an interesting subplot, and suddenly the stew is much richer, but it also takes more bowls to fill it up. Ultimately, I don't think it matters. Artistically, at least. It obviously matters to my publishers, I guess, and to my fans, but it doesn't matter how many books it is because it's one story.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Lord of the Rings was not a trilogy in any classic literary sense. Tolkien didn't think he was writing a trilogy. He divided it into books, but he divided it into six books, if you note,
yeah.
Not three. He thought he was writing one book. But it was so much longer than the other books of the 1950s that his publisher, Allen and Unwin, I believe, decided that they would make it a trilogy. And therefore, they set the template for fantasy trilogies for the next 30, 40 years.
And you know why they split it into a trilogy? Because post-war paper prices were so high, they couldn't afford to print it as a 1,500-page volume.
That's
and here we are. Fantasy trilogies rule.
If Megan, only they had e-books.
Don't go there. Megan, when you started out on the Realm of the Elderlings, it wasn't even called the Realm of the Elderlings, was it? How much of it did you conceive?
Robert Silverberg actually made me come up with a title for that world. He said, "You have to have something to call this thing." When I first started telling Fitz's story, I had actually thought about it for a couple of years before I began writing. And so I fairly much knew the arc, a much wider arc of the story than was written in that first trilogy. Did I think it would take as many books as it has for me to tell this much of the story? No. As George said, you come up with details, and there's other characters who step onto the stage and say, no, I'm a part of this, and I want you to tell more about me. And you start exploring these extra threads that go through the story, and the story stretches out and becomes much longer than you originally thought it would. So I have a fairly good idea of Fitz's life story, but no plans to write the entire thing at that time.
Because it's a big arc.
It is.
I mean, two enormous, enormous stories that you're both telling, and yet here we all are. We love big stories. Isn't that nice to know that we all, in this day of an age where there's so little time to read or do anything, here we all are captured by two really huge epic stories. I love that. Now, you both seem to me to be really nice people, but...
We've got her fooled.
But you put your characters and your readers through hell. You kill your characters off. You torture them. You treat them badly. Are you really, both of you, psychopaths under the skin? I'm going to send that one to you, George, first.
I'm looking forward to the answer to this.
Well, let's see. I could have written a story about a really well-adjusted family and a well-governed realm where Ned Stark comes down and takes over and solves all the problems, and the Seven Kingdoms have a great period of prosperity, and Danny is welcomed back and married off to one of the other noble families of the realm, and occasionally there's a currency crisis or something, but I don't know. Would that have been as exciting?
Might not have taken that one on.
Would you guys have been having as much fun at the Christmas party, saying all or more? I mean, conflict conflict and danger and all of these things are the strong spices that we want. You know, when they occur in our real life, we hate them, but they're part of what makes life life, as opposed to just unending days of boredom, and I think we crave them in our fiction.
I've got a question here from one of our competition winners, called Vanessa Gordon from Newport Beach, and she says, "Have you ever written a character you wanted to kill off, but could not because he or she was needed in the plot?" Megan, have you ever had that problem?
Have I ever wanted? There are George has. Handles so well this large cast of characters. When I get out beyond four or five people, I really think there's one way to simplify this storyline. but that's more about the mechanics of writing rather than actually disliking my characters. I don't think I could write for a long period of time a character that I did not find engaging and fascinating in some ways. I think if I was writing a character that I truly disliked, the result would not be that the reader disliked him so much as the reader would find him boring. So sometimes I've been tempted to do a little bit of weeding to simplify a plot line, but never because it was a character I disliked. I like my characters. I love my villains.
Love your villains. Who's your favorite villain in your... in your
work? Probably Kennet.
I
like Kennet.
So George, taking a scythe to the characters, because of the plot, or because you've grown bored with them, or dislike them, or want to torment us?
Well, I mean, my books are structured with a very limited third-person viewpoint. but I have a large number of viewpoint characters who I switch between to tell the entirety of the story. But that does limit somewhat who I can kill, because sometimes there's only one character who's my eye in a particular location or a particular camp. And if I kill that character, then I'm going to have to introduce another viewpoint character in that camp, or possibly everything going on with that particular subplot is going to be offstage, and my remaining characters are just going to hear about it through the conveniently arriving Raven, which, much as I like Ravens, a succession of chapters where people read particularly interesting letters about battles fought in other parts of the kingdom would probably bring down my editor's wrath upon me. Enough of the Raven letters. So I do have to keep the viewpoint characters in where they are and when they're going to be needed and when something major is going to happen with a particular storyline that I need a pair of eyes and ears to tell. That thankfully is getting a little easier with these last two books, because you know the structure of my books, kind of everyone was together and then they all went their separate ways, and the story has dealt it out, but it's finally reaching the point where it's starting to delt it back in, and the viewpoint characters are occasionally meeting up with each other now and being in the same point at the same time, which gives me a lot more flexibility for killing people.
You're both very good at killing, I have to say. Your fight scenes, both of you, your fight scenes are so brilliant, and very visceral, and very violent. I mean, Megan, you don't look like a woman who could wield an axe. But do you think you could?
Well, I've split my share of firewood, so definitely that sort of an axe.
In anger.
And I've beheaded probably more chickens than George has characters, but it's a whole different feeling when you're doing that kind of messy slaughter work, especially because it's a chicken you've known all its life. And it does give you a perspective on killing, though, that is... right there in your face.
Yeah.
I'm not a particularly martial person. I don't practice any of the martial arts. I've never done anything extremely violent to another human being.
So have you wanted to?
Of course I have. Can I take the Fifth Amendment in the UK?
And didn't I hear you once took up archery, George?
Do I what?
Did you ever take up archery? Or would you have liked to?
I shot a few arrows when I was young, but I wasn't good at that sport any more than I was at baseball or football, so I didn't continue with it. But reading, that was the sport I was good at.
Yeah. So exactly. What did you read? What were your favorite books when you were growing up?
Oh, well, I discovered science fiction fantasy pretty early. I mean, I started out with comic books. I was a comic book guy. My earliest publications, indeed, were letters in the letter columns of Fantastic Four and the Avengers and so forth. Robert A. Heinlein's Have Space, It Will Travel, first science fiction book I ever read. Great book, still. The best of Heinlein's juveniles, and one of the three or four best that Heinlein ever did, and he remains one of the greatest science fiction authors of all time. But that got me in, and then I started buying Ace Doubles and other things at the store, and I met Isaac Asimov and Theodore Sturgeon and Eric Frank Russell and A. E. Van Vogt and all of the great writers who were in paperback back then. Murray Leinster, Edmund Hamilton, C.L. Moore, Lee Brackett. My God, what amazing writers we had.
Lee Brackett, what a great writer.
Yeah.
And somebody who crossed between different genres as well, so it was all about the story.
Yes.
Yeah. And Megan, but how about you? What did you read when you were growing up?
Oh, it really varied throughout my life. probably the first books that I was absolutely enchanted with were the old fairy tale books that my father had that were lavishly illustrated, East of the Sun and West of the Moon with the Kay Nielsen illustration. Because those, they were big, heavy books. You when you opened it, you had a lap full of book, and then there was a piece of tissue paper that was over each color plate that you had to carefully move, and there was a border around the pages of text, and the page, it was a very very rich sensory experience to read these books. And from there, when you went, I went looking for more. I didn't find fantasy and science fiction at book first. I found a lot of myths and legends and Edith Hamilton's mythology. And strange to say, because I was mostly going through our family library, that gives you possibly books that point backwards. So I had Kidnapped, and I had Treasure Island, and I had Robinson Crusoe. A lot of books that all of Kipling and Shakespeare, which you can read Shakespeare. If you're running out of books, you can sit down and read Shakespeare. So that was my rather strange foundation, and I think it was why when eventually I did encounter The Lord of the Rings, it was such a startling revelation.
Well, I think for all three of us, Lord of the Rings has got to be the elephant in the room, the huge, huge presence in all of our lives. George, did your second R, was that actually there to begin with?
No, I was raised a Catholic, and in Catholicism at the age of 13, you undergo what's called confirmation. Where now that you've reached the age of adulthood, 13, you confirm the vows that your godparents took for you during baptism, and you also take a confirmation name, an extra name. So I took my cousin's name, and that became my second R. But
George
Martin
purpose?
Was a pretty boring name. That so the RR I thought was really cool, and I started using it on my. My fanzine stories, but there are a few very early publications of mine with only the one R, which were probably written before the age of 13, before I was confirmed.
Wow.
And I had that second R to add to it. I'm always fascinated by the confirmation thing, because you know, sometimes I get critics or people who object to my characters being so young. They're considerably younger in the books than they are in the TV series. We had to age them up for modern reasons of modern sensibilities and law. But it was very different in the Middle Ages, and you know, there are still legacies of that we can see in modern religions like Judaism. With its bar mitzvah ceremony, today I am a man at age 13, and Catholicism with its confirmation ceremony, today I will take, as an adult of 13, I will take these things. So, you know, we still have the heritage of an age in which children grew up a lot faster, and we're expected to take on a lot more adult responsibilities than modern children.
Certainly children in both of your books grow up very fast. I'm thinking that poor Fitz has such a tough life. You both have outcast characters, and obviously that is partly the conflict. You can't have characters in a comfortable setting, but boy, they start very tough. I mean, poor Fitz in sort of despised.
He does it to himself.
He didn't choose to be a bastard and left on the doorstep, did he?
Perhaps not, but a lot of the decisions, I will sit there and say, don't do that. You're going to make this book three extra chapters long if you do that. And of course, he does it. So what can I say?
Do you ever dream about your characters? This is another of our competition winners. This is from Sharon Curtis in Ontario. Do you ever dream about your characters and your world?
No, not at night.
No.
I do a lot of writing with daydreams, as we used to call them. Sometimes just before I go to sleep, when I'm in bed and I'm reading something, I usually read a little before I go to sleep, and then I turn the light, I'm trying to sleep, but I don't go right to sleep. And that's when my mind turns to my characters and they're coming around in my head. Also on trips, I mean, back in the 1970s, when I was living and working in Chicago, I had about a half hour ride on the elevated train from the part of Chicago where we lived down to the Loop where I worked. And I would sit there and watch the scenery go by on the L, and inevitably I would start thinking about stories and characters. You know, I'm staring out, but I've seen the scenery a million times before, and my mind is just racing ahead of me. And I still do that when I'm driving on a long drive or something like that. It's like you're awake and your mind is working, but there's no immediate stimulus or anything like that, and suddenly the stories start bubbling up. But not during full sleep, no. Dreams are the usual incoherent nonsense that everyone, you know. I mean, like most writers, I said at some point in my career, I know a lot of writers had this experience, you know, say, oh, I have such great, interesting dreams, but I always forget them in the morning, so I'll leave a pad by my bedside, so I'll write them down, you know. And you have a dream, and you have some incredible dream, and you write it down, and the next morning you wake up, and you've written purple socks. Okay, what the hell was I thinking there?
Do you not find that you can solve problems that way, though? Do you not find that in that hypnagogic state, when you just before you're fully awake in the morning, that sometimes solutions come to you for writing problems?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know where the solutions come from. Writing is weird, man. It's weird. I know I don't solve problems with my rational brain. Like the way people solve problems in life, you know, should I take this new job or should I keep my old job? Let's make a pro and con list and weigh, well, you know, higher salary, moving costs, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You're doing that. It's a very rational means of solving a problem. Or with the movie theater I bought in Santa Fe, when we get a problem there and I meet with my manager and we discuss possible solutions, we use our rational brains to solve the problem or to reach a decision. Absolutely no good with writing. I don't know where I reach it. Oh, this is horrible. What did I do here? I've written myself into a dead end, and then I kind of abandon that character for a while. Fortunately, I have a lot of characters, so if I totally mess up with Tyrion, I can just switch to Arya for a while and write about her. And then one day, suddenly, there's the solution to the Tyrion problem. Where the hell did that come from? It wasn't there yesterday, and now I just thought of it. And hey, why didn't I see that all along? Yes, that's exactly what it's got to be. I should have seen that since the beginning. So it's, unless you go with the ancient Greeks and believe in muses whispering in your ear, it's coming from inside me, but I don't know what part of me it's coming from. It's not coming from the rational brain.
It's like there's a back room in the back of your head and everybody works on it, and at the right time the messenger runs to the front and says, okay, here's what you do. But
Or they get lost somewhere along the way.
I've never dreamed about my own characters, but I have incorporated dream territory into books.
The
treasure beach in the other island was from a dream I had that was very peculiar and disturbing and made its way into the book. But sometimes when I am stuck and I will sit there, I become irresistibly sleepy, just really, really tired, and you try to fight it off because you know you've got to get something done. But if I give in and I go just say, I'm just going to lay down on the couch for 20 minutes and rest, sometimes in that you sink right down because you're so sleepy and you're going to fall asleep, and instead you get in that place where you're skipping along the surface and you're not awake and you're not asleep, and suddenly, oh, now I know what I need to do in that scene. So it's not dreaming, really. It's like disengaging and waiting for that messenger to make its way forward.
Disengaging is good, actually. Mm-hmm. I think, yes, that's what it is. It's getting, everything else peels away, doesn't it? And suddenly some clarity comes through from somewhere. goodness knows where.
The muse. The muse is as good an explanation as any.
Like hearing voices while you're in the skill river.
There is also the Raymond Chandler solution that if you get stuck, have someone come through the door with a gun.
Or an axe.
Plus, it would be really startling if someone came through a door with a gun in a Game of Thrones.
Someone had a question on Twitter today, was would you ever sort of go far future into Westeros and actually have technology? That would be hilarious. I have another question from Facebook. Sam Mason on Facebook asks, George, if you were old blood in Meghan's world, what animal would you bond with and why?
Well, she's got dragons, but you have to carve them out of stone, which seems like quite a lot of work to me. And I'm not a skilled sculptor, so my dragon would probably be very ugly. So I have to go with the wolf, man. I mean, come on, wolves, wolves.
I knew it.
We're both wolf people here.
Isn't that weird?
We're both jungle book people.
Jungle, yes.
Yeah, so there it is.
Exposure to Rudyard Kipling at an impressionable age will do that to you.
It does.
Mowgli, man.
It's true.
Kila, yes.
And
my wolves are bigger.
Yes, they are. They are. They are. You went all the way.
Well, that was another question. Who would win? Who would win out of Ghost and Night Eyes?
Oh, come on. Ghost is three times the size.
Three times the size.
Night Eyes is fast, though.
I think they'd sit it out and let, you know.
I think he'd run away.
Fitz and John go at it.
Yeah.
The wolves would just kind of sit there and say, yeah, call us when you're done.
And his second part of his question was, Meghan, who, if anybody, would you prefer to win the Iron Throne?
Ooh. Oh, this is this is hard because I read George's books. I don't get reliable enough TV reception out where I spend most of my time to follow it as film. So I am 100% the books, and right now I'm tending towards Jon Snow.
Hey, Jon Snow likes that.
Oh, yes. I'm going to throw some small questions at you now, which will just be sort of off the top of the list here. Favorite castle, George?
Favorite castle?
Uh-huh.
Let me see. I'm very fond of my castles. And of course, Winterfell is where it all began, so that's probably got to be the choice, Winterfell.
And what would you have based Winterfell on? Did you have a real-world castle in your head when you thought about that one?
Not directly, no. No, it's a fairly simple castle. Its most distinctive feature is the double wall with the moat between. Which I've never seen a real castle that has that particular architectural feature, but I like the size of it and the godswood in the center of it, and you know, it's really more of a town. My castles are bigger than most real world castles.
Yes.
By and large.
Well, especially because they go down as well.
Yes, yes. I'm also very fond of a pike on the Iron Islands. Which was actually based on a couple of Scottish castles, but the idea of a castle that's on these sea stacks,
yeah,
that you know, are very inaccessible and are linked only by these bridges and so forth, it would be a miserable place to live. It would be cold and damp and wet. But it produces explains a lot about the personality of the Ironborn.
You both have a fascination with tunnels as well and secret passages. I want to ask you about secret passages, and you've got them in Buckkeep, you've got them in Withywoods. What's with the secret passages?
I think this goes back to a childhood trauma. When I was growing up, we lived in a house in Berkeley, and it was a big, rambling old house. We were renting it, I'm sure. Some years later, I was talking to my sister about a recurrent dream I had, which was that I am in the bottom of my mother's closet, and I am playing with her red high heels, which we're not supposed to mess with. They came all the way from England. And I see a light, and I pull this panel open, and there's a door, and it's a stairway. And I go down the stairway, and it gets tighter and tighter, and it keeps turning. And finally, I can't go back up, and I can't go down, and I'm just stuck there. Ooh. And it's a recurrent nightmare. And my sister said, oh, yeah, there was a hatch in the back of Mom's closet, and there was a little stairwell that went down to the basement, and you got shut in there one time. So, okay, I don't have a conscious memory of that. I remember vaguely that that there were weird ways to get to the basement of the house in Berkeley, but I do not remember, and I have no idea why there would be an access panel and a weird little staircase going to the basement of a house. So maybe that's where it begins.
Yeah. So I like that. You've got a lot of tunnels.
What can I say? They're cool.
Yeah, they are. They are.
I do actually like caves, you know. I live in New Mexico. We have Carlsbad Caverns, one of the great cave systems in the world. I just visited there again last year on the way to Worldcon, and I've been there, you know, a dozen times over the years, and I've been to other caves when I travel. They're endlessly fascinating. And if I was, you know, 30 years younger and in much better physical condition, of all the sports, I would love to be a caver or an explorer. I mean, it's
spelunking.
It's the last spelunking. True realm of exploration on the planet Earth. It's the only place that at least a theoretical possibility exists that you could crawl through a hole and go to a place that no other human being has ever stood. Yeah. Has ever seen, and you know, the light of your lantern could be the first light that's ever fallen in this secret place below the earth, and you know, that's, I don't know, I find that tremendously exciting, but it is probably akin, I know you, Jane, are a rock climber who clambers to the top of mountains, and it might be somewhat the same appeal.
It's like the opposite.
Yeah.
Because I'm very claustrophobic. I do not like enclosed spaces, and I'm well known when I'm climbing never to get into cracks or chimneys. I will always do something far more difficult up the front face of something.
On the other hand, do not like falling off mountains.
Oh, well, I love that. We did talk about climbing when you were doing your scene for when they went up the wall.
That's right. Jane was my technical resource when for the climb when Jon Snow and the wildlings had to go up that 700 feet of ice wall, and what that would be like climbing that with medieval climbing equipment.
Hard.
Yeah.
I think is the answer to that. We're going to take a few questions from the audience. So if you would stick your hands in the air. Can we take one from this lady at the front here? And then on this side, can you put your hands up here so we're ready for the next one? And we'll have...
Now who's being mean
we'll
to
have
people.
The next one, you down at the front there. So my runners, can you see where you're going? Yes, so this one first.
My question is for both of you, and it's if you'd known how successful and what a phenomenal your work was going to be, is there anything you would have done differently?
That's a tough one, because it's like writing a story. Change one tiny detail and everything changes from that point on. I don't know that I would. I've seen some pretty tough times, and Fred and I went through some pretty hard times when, you know, income depended on fish and editors, neither one of which were especially reliable. He was a fisherman, and there were some hard times, but I don't really think of anything, start writing sooner. That might have been the only thing I would say to my younger self. Start writing now. Don't hesitate. Don't wait for permission. Just do it.
I would have I don't know. I would have done all my promotions for Game of Thrones in a disguise.
I have seen a very effective double for you.
Yeah, that would
we
work.
Should just
too.
Send him
I
out.
I mean, the success of the series is great, but the being a celebrity is something that I have mixed feelings about. The loss of privacy and I don't know, the headlines, they drive me a little nuts. It never ceases to be surreal, the success of the series has brought me. You know, those who follow my blog know I'm a big fan of American football and the New York Giants and the New York Jets are the two teams I follow. And like any football fan, I'm a little crazy when it comes to my team. And, you know, I'm always saying, you know, murder the other team, you know, kill that guy, fire him, he's a bum, you know. That's what sports fans do, you know. And nobody ever took it seriously until I became famous. And then suddenly, you know, Game of Thrones creator calls for Jets coach to be fired. It's appearing as a headline in the New York Daily News. What the hell? There's supposed to be another guy in the crowd here. But actually, it was the general manager, not the coach. I love the coach, Jet. The Jets coach, Rex Ryan. He's great. So that's all I'd do differently. I'd be anonymous. I'd be J.D. Salinger or something. Nobody would know what I look like. No, I wouldn't be J.D. Salinger because I want the books to be published while I'm alive. So I'd be, I don't know, who's a famous writer that nobody knows what he looks like, but he's... So
we
successful.
Live in an age where everybody knows what everybody looks like.
Yeah.
It's very hard.
It's the internet.
But I did see a very good double for you, so I think maybe we should just employ him and send him out into the world.
Excellent.
On your behalf.
Excellent. I'll go for that.
Can we take this question over here?
It was touched on earlier about the underdogs in both your books, and I just wanted to know, was that an intentional thing that you wanted the underdog to like succeed? We see you have like Tyrion, who hadn't the best start in life. And obviously you have Fitz, but it's just something I noticed, especially like with Arya as well, that they didn't have the best start. They weren't probably the ones that you thought would ever get anywhere really, but as the books progressed, I felt that they were the ones that seemed to be getting stronger out of everyone. That's just my opinion of it.
I think that all of us feel like we're underdogs. So when you write a character who starts out with a tough time and has a harder start, not only does it let you develop their skills in interesting ways with a dancing master or a peculiar mentor who's going to teach you to be an assassin, but I think you win the sympathy of everybody who's always, everybody here has felt at one time or another that everybody else in the world had a better shot at things than they did. So when you engage that, you engage the reader, and I think you create a character that brings the reader more fully into the story.
Yeah, I have always had a soft spot for the outsider, the underdog, as you say, cripples, bastards, and broken things, as the title of one of the episodes goes. You know, the angst or that they have in life is makes for more conflict, makes for more drama, and there's something very attractive about that. I mean, my Game of Thrones is full of outsiders of all types, who are all facing. None of them fit comfortably into the society in which they've been born, and they're all struggling to find a place for themselves. In which they're valued and loved and respected, despite what their society considers their deficiencies. And out of that comes, I think, good stories. Good stories.
I saw a hand up on the end here. You were going to ask, yes, is that possible?
I've got a question for Robin based on something that you said earlier tonight. When you began writing as Robin Hobb, did Megan Lindholm's voice change at all?
Not really, because I think when I began to write the fit stories, even though I had not at that point contemplated doing a change in pseudonym, I had already decided on a different storytelling voice for them. You know, we all have our different storytelling voices, and whether you reach back in your mind and you hear in a high and far off time, "O best beloved," which is Rudyard Kipling, or you hear something, you know, from Dr. Seuss, you know, there are all these different storytelling voices. So I knew that when I began writing Farseer, I wanted to use a different voice, a more measured voice. So that voice became the voice I use as Robin Hobb for my stories. Not necessarily Fitz's voice, obviously, if I'm writing the Soldier Son trilogy, but that more measured kind of storytelling. Whereas Maken Lindholm will still jump into the middle of the action and just expect the writer to race along and catch up. So I don't think it really changed at all.
Oh my God, there's a forest of hands now. This gentleman in the front row over here. Thank you.
I'd say another one for Robin. What made you want to go back to Fitz? I'm terrified to read this book because I was happy. Fitz was in a good place. It all felt complete.
It can't all be pony rides and May sunshine, as somebody once said. I went back to Fitz, as I had always intended to go back to Fitz. There was a time for the Rainwilds Chronicles, for that much time to pass in that world, and for time to pass in this world too, because that's actually how my brain works. A number of astute readers have written me letters at some point or another saying, "But I see this, and I see this, and I see this," and you even have a line that says, that the minstrel pauses before sweeping into the final stanzas and chorus. And so some readers, I believe, knew that eventually, yes, this would come. Chronologically, the events do occur after what happens in the Rainwild Chronicles, and I had to have those things happen before certain things can happen in these books. There's also, at the end of Tawny Man, I received quite a wave of email from people who had been sure the story was going to go in a very different direction, one that I had never foreseen myself. So when you get that sort of feedback from a number of people, you stop and say, what's going on here? In the end, I decided to write the story as I had originally conceived it, because basically there's a huge foundation there with all kinds of hooks and hints and seeds that will suddenly become trees, and I didn't want to abandon all that. And also, I don't think I could write a story to order as readers had conceived it, or if an editor said, "No, we want this ending." I don't think I could do it in a way that other than a plodding sentence after sentence until the characters had been dragged kicking and screaming to that conclusion. So it was just time. It was time to do it.
On the end here in the white.
This question's for George. I'm just wondering, how do you create such exotic and beautiful names, for example, Cersei or Daenerys? It intrigues me to know how you create these names.
Names are hard. There's no easy answer to that. I have a library, and have for years, of what to name your baby books. Even though I've never had a baby.
And now all your names are in them.
And I'm always, you know, picking up new what to name your baby books, and you know, what to name your baby books in other countries and all that, and you find cool-sounding names. I do know what's been useless to me is, you know, I thought it would be a cool tool at first, but it's the online fantasy name generator thing. And I've tried those a few times, and we'll generate just just hit this button, we'll generate 50 fantasy names, and they all turn out to be Grisknuckle. But I don't know, maybe I'll use Grisknuckle sometimes. It's, you know, for the right character, any name would do. But a lot of fantasy names are too much to me. They're too difficult to pronounce. I wanted the flavor of medieval England. So that was my goal. So I took some actual medieval names, some actual names that we still use today, like Robert. And in some cases, I tweaked them a little. Like I made Edward into Eddard. If you actually look at the medieval history, people didn't know how to spell their own names. There were a million variants. There are like six known Shakespeare signatures, and no two of them are spelled the same. So there was a lot of variants that we've lost over the years, so some of that could be used. I also wanted to use names. I have a backstory, of course. I have successive waves of people coming to Westeros, and each group has their own types of names. So a certain type of name, a very simple descriptive name, like Stark or Hart or et cetera, denotes first men heritage. Because theirs were what we would think of as simple English words, you know, stout, strong, etc. Then I wanted the Andal names to be slightly more elaborate than that. And of course the Targaryen, the Valyrian names, I wanted a sense of exoticism about that. So they have a lot of Ys and a lot of the AE constructions and so forth. And I also broke naming violations. Conventional wisdom is when you're a writer, they'll tell you as a young writer coming out, never give two characters in a story a name beginning with the same letter, because the readers will get confused.
Simple as you are.
And no. I knew right at the beginning that I was going to have more than 26 characters, so I was in trouble there. I was going to have to violate that one right at the beginning. But then I also studied again history, and you know, English history is like all Henrys and Edwards. Occasionally a Richard sneaks in, but it's mostly, yeah, here's some more Henrys, here's another Edward, here you go, you know. You could actually make a study of all of English history, and it's whenever it is like a Prince of Wales who has a odd name like Arthur or Eustace, you know they're not going to make it. You know? Something always happens to the guys named Eustace before they can climb the throne. We're never going to see King Eustace, I guarantee you that. So I said, well, if English history can be all Henrys and Edwards, I can make mine all Aegons and Daenerys's and, you know, for the Starks, Brandon and all that. But ultimately, it comes down to what sounds right. What sounds right. And sometimes I really wrestle with that because I can't find the right name for a character. And until I find the right name, it's like I don't know who he is and I can't proceed on it. I'd actually like to hear Robin address the name issue, because your naming convention in the Fool trilogy, the Six Duchies, is the most unusual one I've ever seen, with you know, Verity and Shrewd and all of these very descriptive kinds of names given to people. How did you come to that one?
It's not too far off from the old naming magic, though, which is, you know, if you know something's true name, it gives you a power over it. It's also not too far from the very strong tradition of giving children saints names. We're going to name you after St. John. We're going to name you after Francis Xavier. We're going to name our daughters Faith, Hope, Charity, Chastity. A lot of our names that we use commonly, like David or Amy, are actually have meanings such as beloved. So it's not too big of a step. I just wanted to have a layer of the royal tradition that would say, if you know, if you're born from an important family, then we're going to give you a name that's going to help steer your life, and we're going to seal your name to you and try to make you express that virtue. But it was a fun thing to play with, and it was as I say, kind of a kick back to the old naming magic, where if I know your true name, I gain a certain amount of power over you.
You don't have you don't use the royal convention of numbers, though, so there's no chivalry the first and chivalry the second and chivalry the third.
No,
it's just like once a name is used, it's like burned.
there are a few repeats in there, because I really do think that in a world, if you never encountered a repeat of a name, that would be very peculiar. So there are a few repeats scattered throughout the story, but I try not to give two very significant names, significant characters, the same name over and over.
Well, thank you. I'm afraid we have run out of time. I'm so sorry for all of you who had your hands up. I'd very much like to thank Blinkbox for sponsoring and live streaming this event and ensuring that Robin and George's global fans got to experience it as well. Thanks also to the HarperCollins events and publicity team for setting this up, because you've done a fantastic job.
Absolutely.
But most of all, I want to thank our two fabulous authors here tonight, George R. R. Martin and Robin Hobb.
Thank you all for coming, guys.
And Jane, now our watch is done.
Thank you, Jane, for all the editing through all the years.